Just to introduce myself, I'm Benji Thiem. I'm the co-creative director at Compositing. We're a design and animation studio that's been around for over 14 years. And originally, we got our start in the broadcast space. And one of the things I want to talk about is sort of a lot of the changes the industry has been going through lately and how we've gradually gotten more and more into real-time work. But there are some very pivotal projects that brought us to this point that we are today. Originally, back in the day, I remember when we first started using Cinema 4D, and they had first introduced global illumination, right? And it took forever, but everybody was doing it because even though it took forever, the quality difference was enough to justify it. And now, jumping ahead, we sort of built a team full of artists that were generalists, all Cinema 4D artists, and we were one of the first to adopt Octane as a tool set for rendering. Now, that was a crucial point in our history because GPU rendering really revolutionized what we were doing in a creative field. Because GPU rendering had that immediate feedback of you can see as you're working on something what the final result is going to be, right? And that really primed us for what the future was going to hold as well. So I put together a few snippets here. This is all not Unreal work. It's all stuff that we've done over the years for clients, and it's all rendered on GPU in Octane. And one of the things I want you to think about is these are some of the most production-heavy moments from a lot of the pieces that we have done. And the emphasis here is we're not always striving for 100% realism. We're striving to fulfill a creative goal. And the most important thing there is that we have the flexibility to follow our vision and make something happen out of it. So that's kind of where our heads were at when we were thinking, okay, like, how do we get more flexibility? How do we get more creative freedom? How does a small team of artists take their abilities and apply it to a big production without getting completely snowed under by render times and technical issues and all these things that we're used to dealing with? So I want to do a little case study of a project that we did that the whole team decided to jump into Unreal, and it was really a leap of faith for us. In 2017, the president of Promax Games, Steve Kazanjian, approached us to be the design partner on the Promax Games 2018 summit. So this was a conference to celebrate gaming and the people that work in gaming. And since, as a company, a lot of our clients are Blizzard, Activision, Nintendo, Psyonix. We've been doing a lot of work in this space already. So we were super excited about the opportunity to do a piece where we really showcase our love for gaming and sort of a progression where you could see different types of games taking place. So one of our goals for this project was to take an entire team of people who are not used to doing work in real time. Everybody dives into Unreal, and we do this whole project in Unreal. At the time, we had one artist, Alex Kintner, who was actually our concept artist, but was pretty comfortable in Unreal. And he was instructing us on some things, but we did a lot of research ourselves. And we decided to dive in and just see what we could make. So the concept was to basically recreate San Francisco in a stylized fashion create this vivid world that was a celebration of all kinds of different game genres. So at this point, our artists, we're very comfortable right now because We're working all in Cinema, we're concepting, we're modeling things out, we're rigging. These are all things that everybody's familiar with, right? So at this point, we were just having a blast and kind of thinking of like all the crazy things that we could add into this piece. But it was a little bit unclear, like, what are the hurdles that we are going to run into when we do this? So with the help of Alex, we jumped into Unreal. The first big part of it was what animation systems can we bring into Unreal that we've created in Cinema 4D, and which ones do we have to rebuild in Unreal? So we did a lot of exploration. We ended up doing some of the particles in Cascade, which worked out really well. We built procedural animated textures using the node-based systems in Unreal. And we basically created as much as we could, including building all the environments. We built them in Unreal as well. So then came a challenge for our animators and traditional Cinema 4D artists, is how do we take all this animation that we've been doing in Cinema for our animatics and translate those over to Unreal? At the time, there wasn't really clear documentation about how to do this. So there's a lot of experimentation involved, like what do you have to do to bake out a character animation and bring it into Unreal? What do you do if it's a dynamic object and you want to bake that out and bring it into Unreal? So we did a lot of experimentation, and there were certain things at the time that didn't work as well, but I'm happy to say that now that process has become completely seamless. We have it down where even without baking characters, we can bring them from Unreal, from Cinema to Unreal. There's a new Datasmith plugin which just got announced, which allows you to open an entire scene in Unreal. So you can actually save out your Cinema 4D file using the Save for Melange feature, which is now being rebranded to the Save for Cineware feature. And you can save out your entire cinema scene, open it in Unreal, the hierarchies come through and everything. And that's just, the process is becoming so seamless now that there's, like for us, I mean, we had built this whole thing using a more difficult process, and now it's so much easier. But so I'm gonna loop the final piece that we made while I talk about some of the things that we got out of this process of working with Unreal. First of all, what really blew our minds was that all the things that we conceived in the creative brainstorming, we were actually able to include. Because once we had a base, we sort of built the map out, we had the characters. Once we had that base, iteration, changing things, adding things was so quick and so easy because everything is happening in real time, right? So this is actually a pretty long piece, but we weren't faced with weeks of rendering. We weren't faced with all those usual problems you run into. So that was a huge thing. So leading right off of that is the concept of a production timeline. When you're working in a traditional pre-rendered pipeline, you have to schedule 25% to 30% of your project just for rendering, compositing, fine-tuning, all that stuff. And while it's still good practice to have a locked-in date where you're locking picture, it's important to note with a project like this, where you have everything existing in real time, there's no need to stop changing things at a certain point. You can, the day before a project is due, you can change the character animation, bring it back through the process, re-render it in the matter of minutes. So it completely changes the way you can view production, and it puts a lot of control in the creative's hands, which is what's important to us. And that also leads to the idea of compositing. Compositing is a really interesting thing because even back when we were doing GPU rendering, we started to realize that a lot of the reason our composites were so huge was we were trying to avoid having to go back and render stuff. You're trying to build in flexibility by doing all these passes so that you can change things in the future, right? Well, when you have an Unreal workflow, there's no reason to not just go back into the project, make the visual tweaks that you want there, and then re-render it because the render time is almost non-existent, right? So the interesting thing too is there's a lot of built-in tools for color correction, lens effects, things like that that you would normally do in post, post-post as we like to call it, And now you can just handle them in engine. So my recommendation is if you're going to jump into this process, take it as far as you absolutely can within Unreal. And then from there, you might have to only do a couple tweaks in compositing. And then the other factor is the sequencer. A lot of people don't really understand the power of the sequencer. But basically, you can do entire edits in Unreal. So you don't have to render out shot by shot, bring it into Premiere, or bring it into After Effects and put it all together. You could technically have your whole sequence just living with the audio in Unreal and be able to preview it there. So these are all things that are really helping our production along the way. One thing, a happy surprise, we recently did a 2-minute trailer that was a 4K trailer for a gaming company, right? And usually delivery process is interesting, right? You're delivering this huge render, and then sometimes the client needs some kind of flexibility, or they might need to change things in the future, right? Well, normally we're faced with, okay, which files do I collect out? Do I make them an AE collect that has certain components of this? Or do I have to also save out the 3D files that went into the AE collect so that they have the flexibility they need? Well, with this trailer that we recently did, we delivered the entire trailer, which was rendered at 4K. And alongside of that, we delivered one Unreal project that was 8 gigs that could render every single shot that had created that trailer. And the client could go in and make any last-minute changes they needed for legal reasons or whatever. And it wasn't a hassle on us. They didn't have to charge us overages. It was all, it all made total sense. So the delivery process is changing. The way we see compositing is changing. So many things are being affected by this. Another thing I wanted to mention, too, that's a huge workflow thing is, as traditional artists, we weren't really used to the idea of version control. So normally the way we would do things is we would have our 3D files, we'd have an artist work on them, and then we would hand the files back and forth. And they would have to kind of see, oh, okay, this is how they set it up, and this is where I go from there. With Unreal, it's all set up in a way that you can apply something like Perforce version control, and then all of a sudden, you can split out your scene. So you have one shot. You can say, okay, one artist is now working on the environment. One artist is now working on the lighting. One artist is now working on cinematic cameras and animations. And they're all working simultaneously. And with one sync of a button, those all combine into a master file that can be rendered out. So that's another thing. When you're up against a deadline, and you don't know how you're going to pass all your files back and forth in time to get a render up and get it out, it's so helpful to be able to have that simultaneous workflow that syncs, and then being able to render in real time, you can just get shots out the door faster than ever. So these are all things that we've sort of learned over the process of working with Unreal. And this was over a year ago that we did this. Since then, we've done a virtual set for NFL Red Zone. We've done a lot of smaller projects with Ross Video. And recently, we did an entire trailer with Psyonix for the new Radical Summers event that was all rendered in Unreal. And we even included a lot of ray tracing features as well. And so this type of work is just taking off for us. It's an amazing process. We're super into it. We have a couple of big projects launching right now. And if, by the way, if you want to check out the Radical Summers trailer, I couldn't show it here because there's so many IPs involved, but it's a really cool piece, and it's on YouTube if you just look up Radical Summers Rocket League. And you can kind of see where we're taking this process. So we're in the midst of exploring how far we can push the production, how much realism we can add in, what can we do with character animation. And we're super excited of being able to work with the new tools that Maxon and Unreal have been working with together. So it's a bright future for us, and we just wanted to be here to share what we can, what we're doing, and where we see the industry going. Thank you.